This video is all about painting realistic eyes, and today we're going to look at adding a pupil and painting the reflections. Hello, I'm Paul Hopkinson, a professional wildlife artist. I work online and I love to teach my watercolour painting techniques here on YouTube and within my online school. Today, I want to focus on adding specific details within an eye, the pupil and also the highlight. Both give the eye life, and getting them right is essential. So here are 5 tips and tricks to help you do just that. Let's get started. Your work around the pupil enables it to sit within the eye. As you can see, I don't start with the pupil anyway. For this tiger, I have left an area for both the pupil and the highlight. It gives me a picture to place the pupil within, and it makes positioning it and getting the shape right a bit easier. The area directly surrounding the pupil is often filled with detail. Now, these fine marks almost frame the pupil and often radiate from a point at the centre of it. You need to work carefully to ensure these radiating lines are painted at the correct angles. The pupil is really important, and getting it right is vital. So often I see eyes being painted with a pupil that's too big, too small, or simply the wrong shape. The eyes are the first thing that you notice within a painting. At best it can be a distraction, at worst it can make the animal look cross-eyed. I can still see the pencil lines from my reference drawing, and I use these as a starting point. However, I would always suggest working within the lines to begin with. It's so much easier to make them fractionally bigger as opposed to trying to make them smaller once you've committed yourself to some dark paint. Now, the dark paint I'm using isn't actually black. It's a mixture of phthalo blue, alizarin crimson and lemon yellow. I do use black, and I'll pop a card to the top right for videos on black paint and how I use it within my paintings. Notice how the pupil is an elongated sort of squashed oval, and that it blends into the shadow cast by an object within the reflection. Paint this as you see it, but allow the shapes to merge with one another, as they are within the photograph. As I work on the shadow, you can see that I've switched to a lighter, browner mix, and I'm taking this into the eyelid in a natural blend. This draws the whole line together and enables the colours to all work together too. At the same time, I blend out the bottom edge of the shadow into the colour within the centre of the eye. I do this by using a clean, damp brush, lightly tickling the paint and encouraging it to blend where I want it to go. I use the same colour within the detail radiating from the pupil, and again, this helps the painting work as a whole piece. Eyes are really complex, and in order to make them look realistic, you need to vary your brush strokes and use a range of techniques to create different shapes, marks and detail. For the shadow area, I've literally just painted it in the traditional way. This has resulted in an area of one colour blended out at the bottom. But now I'm creating marks by gently moving my hand in a random fashion across the paper surface and lightly grazing it with the tip of the brush to create tiny patterns within the iris. I can then change the marks and switch to stippling. Notice how much more vertically I hold the brush as I create small tiny dots of colour across the paper surface, keeping them random as before, but obviously a lot smaller. Finally, I can scumble. Now for this, the brush is held at a shallower angle and the side of it is gently grazed across the paper surface. This makes use of the textured surface, which catches the paint in a random way. Painting what you see in the reflection sounds obvious, but you may start to think that what you're doing isn't going to look right. It's going to look too obvious, too much like a house or a person or even a telegraph pole. This is because as you work on a reflection, you're focused just on that tiny area of the eye. In reality, your painting is going to be viewed from much further back, and the reflection is going to be just a small part of the whole picture. So, in this piece I can see what looks like a window reflected within the tiger's eye. This has created a sort of a grid pattern, and that's exactly what I'm going to paint. The grid has slightly wobbly lines, but is clearly some sort of window. Now that looks odd at the moment, but when everything else is painted and it sits within a context, it becomes completely believable and an important aspect of the painting. As you can see in the finished painting, where it all begins to make sense. And this leads us to my 5th tip, and that is to reassess the tones that you have already painted. All our paintings are about creating tonal values. However, it can be very difficult to work this out in the early stages of a painting. With watercolour, we generally start light and we're working tones that are gradually getting darker. Some artists do intend to start with their light tones, then they work on their dark tones, and finally they add their mid-tones. I tend to vary how I work, depending on what aspect of an animal I'm working on. Within this eye, I gradually worked up through the tones and then I added the pupil. Now the pupil is probably the darkest part within this area, and it wasn't until this was painted that I was able to assess whether my other darks were dark enough. I could then intensify the colour around the edge to really start to bring the eye together and make it all work as a whole study. You can see I'm now starting to take this colour out into the surrounding fur, which will be the next stage of this painting. Do leave me a comment if you found these tips useful and are going to use any within your own paintings. And if you would like to see more tiger painting, I'll pop a link to a video in the top right of the screen. I'll see you there.